All right. Good evening. We are back for part two of the public hearing, which the first part was held several weeks ago. This is the second year that we tried to split it up in the sense that instead of just having one at the very beginning of the process, and then you have work sessions, and then you read things in the paper and all that sort of thing, and then there's no outlet to official outlet to come on back, we tried to add that component to it. So, albeit perhaps imperfect at times, hopefully it's some aid. And like we said, we did it last year and doing it again this year. And appreciate y'all coming out in less than perfect weather. So, before we get going, I believe that the city manager had a few brief remarks. I'll make a very brief remark or two, and then we'll go over what will be, for those of you that were here last time, a very similar process to the last time around.
Thank you, Your Honor, and good evening. Tonight we are reconvening the public hearing of May 2nd, 2006, regarding the fiscal 2007 budget. Subsequent to that public hearing, the City Council conducted four budget work sessions, which included the Police Department, Fire Department, School Department, and Municipal Departments. All work sessions were televised. It should be noted that this budget process began in November 2005, when the Joint Budget Committee met to discuss the process for the fiscal 07 budget. Since that time, there have been numerous meetings and discussions with various departments regarding the fiscal year 07 budget, which have included three public hearings. The Fire Department conducted a public hearing on their budget on February 8, 2006. The School Department actually conducted two public hearings in February on their budget, and the Police Department conducted a public hearing on March 7, 2006. In addition, there were two public hearings on the Capital Improvement Plan. One took place before the Planning Board in January, and another before the City Council in March. Tonight is the final public hearing in the fiscal 07 budget process. After tonight's public hearing, the City Council will conduct a work session on June 13th to finalize the budget and will formally act on it at their regular meeting on June 19th. Once the budget is adopted, the funding for the fiscal year 07 will commence on July 1st, 2006. With that, Your Honor, I'd like to turn it back to you and open it up for the public hearing.
Great. Thanks very much. A couple of ground rules. Those of you that have been here before, it will probably sound very familiar. Something that we did last time, I think it went pretty well, and I'm going to suggest we do the same thing this time out of respect for all the folks that are may not be in the first five people in line, is we have three rounds, which is the norm for a public hearing. I'm going to propose 3 minutes per round again. It seemed to be a positive decision last time. There are a lot of people that if you're number 20 in line and you don't have some sort of limit on time on each round, you're in a position where being 20th in line means you may not get a shot at it, or at least you'll be several hours into it before you do. But keep in mind that certainly you can and are encouraged to stick around for a second round if you so desire. After everybody who's had a first chance to speak has done so, obviously you can sit around and listen more, or you can go home after the first round as well. And we'll do the same thing in terms of a third round. One thing I would suggest, and perhaps in one moment we could do, is in order to facilitate it as well, I think people intuitively got to get in line so as to minimize the amount of time between presenters, and we'll go first come, first serve, but again, trying to keep it at 3 minutes per person per round. So in theory, somebody could speak for up to 9 minutes if they so desired. The second thing I would say is that in addition to the three-minute limit that we're instituting, the saying that brevity is the soul of wit, it's also the soul of effectiveness, I can say in terms of from this side of the table, that getting the point across, particularly if it's a point that has been said many times, certainly there's power in numbers, but if it's something that you've said, that somebody prior has said, and it's something that you feel strongly, saying that you agree wholly and ditto and that sort of thing in order to facilitate it, we appreciate that, and I suspect a lot of the people in the audience appreciate it. We see you here, and we want to know what you think, and certainly to the extent that it's original information or opinion, that moves it along and gives everybody a shot at it. The third thing, and it seemed to go very well last time, especially after the beginning, was it seemed like a pretty civil discussion last time around. Obviously, that's critical to these sort of things working well. Whether you're watching at home or you're here or you're one of the counselors, civility is the lubricant that allows these things to go well, to run smoothly. So I'd ask, regardless of what you think of somebody's position, agree or disagree, if you could keep groans, sighs, epithets, four-letter words, all these sort of things to yourself. That probably improves the chance we get some civility in that process. And the last thing I would say, and I think I speak for most, if not all, the council in this regard, is that you've hopefully had a chance to see the public, the work sessions. Many of you might have been here for the first public hearing, and one of the things that I think is critical, it's pretty clear that we have some agreement in terms of a general amount of money, in terms of a tax increase that we're prepared to look at. You'll hear numbers all from very, very low to very, very high, and the reality is that a number will end up at neither extreme. And so to the extent that any of you, whether you come espousing a very a full request of a given department or the opposite extreme, there'll be people that'll probably say, don't increase things a lick. It will be very difficult to do either of those two things without significant ramifications for other departments that are also part of the equation. So when you're espousing for or against a large or small number for a department, with not passing judgment on it, simply saying that a big part of our decision-making process will be, how does that decision affect other decisions that we have to make with the other departments, our capital budget, debt reserve, things of that sort. And that's really what the crux of our discussion for the next week to 2 weeks is going to be, is figuring out how to make the pieces work. So if you can help us, we understand where you're coming from. If you want X, then what part of Y is less critical? Not saying it's not important, but perhaps less critical or less important. Not passing judgment on it, simply that'll help us in making a decision. So I apologize for all that, but hopefully it'll help. And at this point, perhaps we can begin. Like I said, lining up is probably the way to go. And whoever would like to kick it off should feel free to do so. And if you could begin to line up behind whomever that is, that would be great.
Your Honor, if anyone could turn off cell phones, too. Yeah,
that's good. Thank you, Councilor Smith. If you got a cell phone, if you could put on vibrate or quiet, that would be great. And also, I apologize for not mentioning it, if you could give your name and address for the city clerk in order for making it all official, that would be great, too. So with that, let us begin.
Rick Horowitz, 127 Gates Street. just quickly like to go through some budget facts. Budget fact number one, every department has grown spending in each year for the past 10 years. Last year, the budget grew 5.6%. The prior year, it grew 8%, while inflation in the last 2 years averaged only 3%. Fact number two, average annual budget growth since 1996 has been 4.4%, while CPI growth has been 2.5%. The schools, police, and fire have all grown above the inflation rate for the past 10 years in each year. Fact three, Portsmouth schools, which comprise 54% of the city budget, spend 36% more per student than the state average, yet their results are pretty much in line with the state average. Fact four, with 297 teachers and 2,572 students, Portsmouth schools employ one teacher for every 8.6 students. In addition, they employ teaching assistants, paraprofessionals, administrators, coaches, and other employees as well. There's more than one employee for every five students in the schools. Fact five, in the past 15 years, due primarily to the Pease closure, our population has dropped significantly. In 1990 census, we had 26,000 residents. We're now down to less than 21,000, almost a 20% drop. Yet city staffing has grown significantly during that time. It's difficult, in my mind, to make a case that there's no waste in the city budget. Fact six, a lot of people probably don't know this, but city employees get a pretty healthy health insurance package. And if they turn it down because their spouse has health insurance, they'll actually get cash in lieu of that health insurance for whatever the premium cost was going to be. I wanted to make another comment on a little bit different note. It's a comment about our schools. A lot of people here probably think that, you know, I don't care about the schools or I hate the schools and want to see them shut down. Actually, the truth is I want to see our schools be great schools. I just don't want to see them consume every dollar in everyone's pocket. And I'd just like to bring to everybody's attention, particularly the parents who have children in the schools, that they should go online and take a look at how the schools, not just in Portsmouth, but across the United States, compare to the schools in Just for example, Korea, Japan, Singapore, Hong Kong, and not just the Asian countries, most of the European countries as well. The comparisons are not good, particularly in math and science. Our students perform near the bottom of the pack out of 30 countries rated. In fourth grade, we're near the top. In eighth grade, we're around the middle. By 12th grade, we're near the bottom of the pack. And what I would, what I'd like to say to everybody is that, you know, we all got to start working together and working smarter here. It's not just about spending more and more and more money. We need to start figuring out what the successful schools in our own country and what these successful schools in other countries are doing to get this kind of performance. And we got to start doing it, because your children are not going to be competing against each other. They're going to be competing against people from China and India and Japan and Eastern Europe and all these other countries. Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Boyd Morrison. I live at 210 Broad Street in Portsmouth. I'm here to speak about the Portsmouth High School athletic director position. I understand that the counselors will have quite a few tough decisions to make in the gleaning and leaning of the budget. However, I would like to speak to something that I think has been a glaring deficiency that's certainly exposed itself over the past few years, and I urge you to consider it. In Portsmouth, there's a limited and inadequate number of fields and practice facilities, and therefore demand is very high. As a result, the Portsmouth High School athletic director deals with many, many other youth programs. Now, out of 1,050 students approximately at the high school, we've heard estimates between 60 and 65% of those students are competing in some kind of sport. These are truly student athletes. So if we look at approximately 650 students who are using the athletic facilities at Portsmouth High School, please don't forget that we also have, with youth football, lacrosse, Portsmouth City Soccer, we have young men and women, boys and girls, who are another 650 to 700 children who are also using these facilities. I think for those of you who don't know this, Portsmouth High School is, in fact, due in many reasons to the paucity of fields we have throughout the city, is the epicenter of youth sports. Therefore, I suggest that this athletic director is not just a school position or a school department position, but it's a community position. In addition to all the schools, freshmen, JV and varsity sports, of basketball, tennis, baseball, softball, track and field, field hockey, lacrosse, we have quite a few other people who are there. So my premise is that Portsmouth High School students and athletes and the young competitors behind them deserve and need this position to be filled by the best and most qualified person, someone with the administrative efficiency, acumen, coordination, fairness, and vision. We need to return this, Portsmouth High School and the community, to position both in perception and action of excellence. The attempt to play around the edges at funding this position has totally and utterly failed, and I strongly urge the school board, the city council, and the city manager to work together to fund this important community position. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Marchant, Assistant Mayor Farini, City Councilors, City Manager Bohanko, and Attorney Sullivan. My name is Bob Lister, and I reside at 69 Diamond Drive, and I'm probably the proudest person in the room tonight because I'm the superintendent of schools. I usually don't speak at public hearings, especially on the budget, but I feel compelled this evening to say a few words. Within all facets of the Portsmouth Public Schools, we've been talking about culture and climate. What that means is that employees promote a safe and challenging environment with specific expectations and accountability for all students and staff, regardless of what position they hold. We have an emphasis on curriculum, instruction, assessment, professional development, and community. As we continue through what I consider a lengthy, unpredictable, laborious, opinionated budget process over the past few months, I'd like to recognize and commend the faculty and support staff in the schools for their professionalism and perseverance. They have not once diverted their attention from children, even after daily barrage of negative messages about their performance. I would also like to acknowledge the parents who are advocates for the schools, the school board committed for excellence, but more importantly, acknowledge our students for working hard every day and continuing to attend school, given the climate that the city in the city that has cast doubts on the schools with the amount of misinformation that is perpetuated by some speakers and the media. Some staff members that I work with are worried about whether or not they'll have a job next year, whether they can remain in the community that they love. We've been accused of having failing schools, even though our test scores show a much different picture. Even magazines like Newsweek continually focusing on negative messages rather than positive to its readers by writing articles entitled, Why Johnny Can't Read. We know why Johnny can't read. Let's do something about it. It's called having resources available for quality instruction. Headlines in the community include, Portsmouth budget cuts mean lost teachers. Imagine this above the fold, community working together for education. We have had difficulty in attracting teachers and administrators to the Portsmouth School Department this year because of the media coverage and what's happening in the city. You've heard me say before that we want a quality education in Portsmouth for all students, not an adequate education, but a quality education. We turn no students away in the Portsmouth public schools, whether they're homeless, they have special needs, have certain socioeconomic status, whether they're gifted and talented, whether they're in need of breakfast, or just one of those kids who show up every day, do their best and contribute in their own way as a good citizen. Through our recent presentations to the community, we proudly presented many of the services and student and programs that we offer to students and their families. I would once again remind the community, these are not your grandfather's schools. In addition, we are continually cognizant of the fact that we want to offer the best education in our schools while being sensitive to the taxpayers. 40%, including myself, 40% of the school employees live in Portsmouth and also pay taxes. Many communities are facing similar issues that we are, but I believe that we are not just any community. We ask the City Council and community to support quality education. And once again, I applaud the class, the dignity, and the professionalism of the employees of the Portsmouth School Department. In closing, let me say how proud I am of our students in academics and athletics and all extracurricular activities. Our community offers an unbelievable amount of financial support through scholarships, and several of our athletic programs have recently competed in state tournaments. This doesn't happen by accident. An example is just yesterday, the Portsmouth High School girls lacrosse team, who because of lots of talent, good attitude, good coaching, and a supportive community, competed in the Division III state championship tournament in Manchester. I congratulate them. Thank you very much.
My name is Tamara Leibowitz, and I live at 30 Aldrich Court. I am the parent of two children at Dondero Elementary School, and although I do not have a connection with the association, I am a Portsmouth taxpayer. I have attended many of these meetings and work sessions and have listened with interest to this budget process. My understanding is that the school board was asked to prepare a budget that would meet their needs and continue their goal of providing quality education for all of our children. They have been seeking a budget that would allow continuation of all programs and the reinstatement of some positions that have been cut in the past. The response has ranged from understanding, concern, anger, and even resentment. While many arguments have been posed about the affordability of housing and the increased cost of living, which are all valid concerns, this issue tonight is about making a decision about the coming year's budget. Making extensive cuts to our city and school budgets will not create affordable housing, it will not lower health care premiums, or it will not make heating oil more affordable. As you consider this year's school budget, I urge you at a minimum to vote for the revised 6.4% increase that was proposed by the school board. While this will not allow for the restoration of previously lost positions, doing so will allow the schools to continue to provide quality education to our children, including the maintenance of smaller class sizes, the ability to provide individualized education, and the ability to continue to hire highly qualified and experienced teachers. It will also allow the schools to continue to meet mandates of No Child Left Behind and special education requirements. A lower amount could result in staff or program cuts, and one thing that has become become abundantly clear watching this process is that once positions and programs are cut, it seems nearly impossible to get them back. Our schools, like our other city services, are a vital part of our society. Whether it's our fire or police department, services for our senior citizens, or schools for our children, we should stand together as a community and lift up each other. Thank you.
Good evening, City Councilors, Mayor Marchand, John Bohinko. My name is Bob Hasseld. I live at 15 Mount Vernon Street in Portsmouth. I have a paper in front of me here that throws a number out like 8% increase in the budget. Then I read that it's 4.23% that the city manager is recommending. Is this a ploy? I mean, why do we start off at 8 and say to the people of Portsmouth, well, it's only going to be 4%? Well, 4% is much too much. There are a lot of people out here that have very little income coming into their houses. And I see a lot of teachers here, young people. I'm 75. You guys are all in your 20s, 30s. Your income level is growing. Mine is not. And I can't afford the taxes that are slated for the next year budget. And there are many people that are not here tonight because they're so darn mad that the budget is going so sky high. It's way beyond what it should be. Steve, you said in your mayoral contest running for mayor, more bang for your buck. I would like to see, or I'd like to have a 6-month appraisal of what that bang for the buck has been soon to see where you're giving us a better bang for the buck. Could that be arranged, please? Anyway, I can't afford it, and there are many people right out here in this audience, elderly people who cannot afford to pay the taxes. And I don't want to see one person move out of this city because they can't afford it after they've been here for 40 years and they grew up in the town. I'm a newcomer here, but I don't want to move either because I love the city. But please, I have 3 words for you, and that is hold the line. Remember that. We elected you to the post that you're at, and we're hoping that you will hold that line and keep us in mind, the people that voted you in. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Jim Nevin. I live at 187 Monroe Street Extension. I wrote this about 20 minutes ago, and unfortunately, it's probably going to sound like it. I went to the school board meeting. And I walked away thinking the following. If I was a teacher, I would like to have a principal. And then I thought about if I'm a coach, I'd like an athletic director. Nancy Claiborg stated, I know I got the first number right. I'm not sure about the second number. But she mentioned that we are 4th out of, I believe, 47 high schools in the state of New Hampshire academically. I'm wondering if we're close to 4th out of those 47 schools, out of the 47 high schools in New Hampshire athletically. I went to the lacrosse playoff game in Manchester. And I also went to the one in Portsmouth. I found out that a parent lined the field for that playoff game. As a coach of 2 sports, I feel I'm part of the feeder system for the high school. I would like my players fed with an athletic director. I look forward to an athletic director. If not, Nancy Clayburg mentioned the possibility of paying $100 to somehow fund the athletic director position, and I'd be more than happy to pay that $100. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Marchand, city councilors. My name is Rich Carlin, a Greenland school board member and vice chair of the joint SAU 50 school board representing the towns of Greenland, Newington, Newcastle, and Rye. With me this evening is Dr. George Cushing, superintendent of SAU 50, Martha Stone, school board chair from Greenland, Jack Anderson, school board member from Newington, Ian Grant, school board chair from Rye, and Ron King from the Newcastle school board. We'd like to just read you a short letter we've sent you in support of the Portsmouth School Board's proposed budget. Dear Mayor Marchand and City Council members, the joint school boards of School Administrative Unit 50, encompassing the school districts of Greenland, Newcastle, Newington, and Rye, respectfully request that the Portsmouth City Council approve the Portsmouth School Board's revised budget. As you are aware, Greenland, Newcastle, and Rye tuition their students to Portsmouth High School, and Newington's tuitions its students to both Portsmouth Middle School and Portsmouth High School. The students from SAU 50 tuition to Portsmouth High School comprise more than one-third of the high school student body. Portsmouth School District's revised proposed numbers would be necessary to stop any further regression in terms of staffing, class size, and programs. The proposed increase is necessary to maintain staff at the current levels and would add a minimal number of instructional positions that have been needed for several years. Even with the passage of the proposed budget amount, there will be less staff than 4 years ago. As elected representatives, we too are fully aware that with escalating costs, tough budgetary decisions need to be made. It's our belief that the Portsmouth School Board has been fiscally responsible and has made those tough decisions, both in the proposed 2006-2007 budget and over the last 4 years. As members of the SAU 50 School Board, we firmly believe that a continuation of further staff reductions at the middle and high school levels will be detrimental to the excellent educational program that our school districts have come to expect from the Portsmouth School District. Please accept the Portsmouth School Board's proposed budget. Thank you.
Good evening, and thank you to the members of the City Council for convening this hearing and for allowing the opportunity for public commentary. My name is Amy Schwartz. I live at 55 Sunset Road in Portsmouth. I am the Associate Director of the New Hampshire Institute for Health Policy and Practice at the University of New Hampshire, and I am also the incoming President of the Parent Teacher Association for Dondero Elementary School. I have a daughter in sixth grade at Portsmouth Middle School, and my son is a fourth grade student at Dondero. I have listened to and read intense and divisive commentary regarding the City of Portsmouth budget, specifically the school budget, and as a public policy researcher and a concerned parent, I felt I should take the time to comment. Russ Thibault, President of Applied Economic Research based in Laconia, New Hampshire, recently completed a study of new residential development and school enrollment and concludes, in closely examining school district budgets in many communities in the state, you will find that a third or more of these costs are paid by state and federal grant sources, which rise as enrollment grows. Although state and federal aid varies from community to community, in many cases, property tax-funded costs can be significantly lower than the total cost per student. In other words, we need to remember that schools are not funded exclusively by property tax. I, for one, do not want to gut the future of our school infrastructure for a vocal few. We should think of ourselves as stewards of the entire community and recognize that resources distributed and invested in schools now pay off later in the form of an educated and diversely skilled workforce. Research which correlates individual education and future economic status is well established. Research which correlates good schools and subsequent positive effects in the general economy is fledgling, but is nevertheless promising. In speaking with Dennis DeLay, an economist with the Workforce Opportunity Council, a coalition of New Hampshire businesses and agencies which oversee workforce development, said, "As an economist, I know that K-12 education is a public good. We know that society as a whole is better off with an educated population, which is why countries create public school systems in the first place. Smart, creative parents who hold good jobs and manage good companies also want to send their kids to good schools, and so one could also make the argument that well-funded schools benefit the economy directly. A talented and educated workforce is essential to support economic vitality. An educated workforce begins with a sound, well-funded primary school system. It's important to note that as the types of education and training required to make this generation of workers successful, it is not your grandfather's school, as someone mentioned, are more demanding and sophisticated, we press our schools to meet these rising expectations. We ask our schools to do more for our students. We ask that our good jobs be retained in our community so that we can experience a sound local economy. This has not happened with a skeletal education budget, and we need to fully fund the budget as proposed. We need to acknowledge that a vibrant mix of ages and stages are what makes a community strong. Curb cuts on our publicly funded sidewalks work equally well for bicycles, wheelchairs, and strollers, and as such, we need to think creatively and begin to define community in a more generous and extended way. An intergenerational effort must be undertaken. Communities which work for elders must be designed to work for families, too. Families need to be locally sustained through mixed-use planning in order to provide a ready employment and tax base to deliver services to the rest of the population of any city. Rather than building factions, we need to recognize that our community fabric shares its threads and that a well-funded school means a greater future for Portsmouth. I would suggest that as soon as possible, we convene a community-based study committee comprised of all citizens and elected officials to bring a thoughtful and careful consideration of all ideas presented to make our schools effective and efficient while meeting the goal of the highest possible achievement for our young people.
My name is Cindy Hebert. I live at 240 Thaxter Road, and I'm here to ask you to support this school department budget. And a lot will be said here tonight, so I think I'll put this briefly and very simply. Here's what I know. Students do better academically in reasonably small classes. At this time of year, our schools should be recruiting and hiring excellent teachers. To attract families to this community, we need successful schools. We have a great school system with dedicated teachers, staff, and administrators. And I'm asking you to listen to the people who are elected and hired to work for the best interest of students. Please support the school budget. Thank you.
Mayor Marchand, members of City Council, my name is Jerry Stowe. I live at 579 Sagamore Avenue, Portsmouth. I've heard a lot of positive comments about the school this evening, and I would agree that schools are important. As a former university professor, I can attest to that fact. However, I don't think we need to break the bank at the expense of the taxpayers to provide good education. I'd like to share some facts with you. Many classes in the high school have fewer than 15 students in a class, with a significant number of these classes having under 10 students. Excuse me. Some classes have as few as 5 students. Some examples: 2 classes of English 9, one with 9 students and the other with 7 students. 2 classes of 1950s America, one with 8 students and the other with 9 students. Counselor, this is high school we're talking about. These classes are unnecessarily small. I think the City Council needs to request the course and enrollment listings and work with the school board, and you'll see room to consolidate course offerings and electives at the high school. Listing makes it pretty obvious that there is waste in our spending. I'd just like to say one more thing. I think some people have talked about the older folks in this community not being able to afford the taxes. We are in danger of losing the socioeconomic fiber that has made Portsmouth the great city that it is to live in. So I urge you to step up and do the right thing. And at the risk of sounding facetious, I don't think we all like tuna fish. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Hank Sanders. I'm a resident of Portsmouth. I grew up south of here in the Commonwealth of Taxachusetts. In 2003, I moved here from Connecticut, where similar problems were developing. My wife and I love Portsmouth. The council has got to do a better job with controlling spending. We and many others want to both happily and actively remain here. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Marion Ellis, and I reside at 235 McKinley Road. I'm a parent of a 7-year-old who is finishing his first grade year at Dondero and a 4-year-old who will join him there in a year. I'm here tonight to ask you to support the entire budget for the good of our entire community. My husband and I moved here 12 years ago, and when we chose to buy our home 6 years ago, we didn't even think about looking elsewhere, anywhere except Portsmouth because of the schools, even though our first child was only 1 year old at the time. Districts develop reputations, and Portsmouth has a strong one. We were recently faced with the decision of whether to renovate our house or move to another town, and we decided to stay. We can't imagine living anywhere else. We're so lucky to live in this community with our new library coming, top-notch police and fire departments, and a recreation department that offers amazing programs to all. I support all of these budgets, but the schools are particularly close to my heart because I am not only a parent, but I've been a proud member of the faculty of the Portsmouth Middle School for nearly 10 years. But Portsmouth is not a cafeteria where you can choose to support a certain part of the budget because that is the one you use. So I don't want to focus on just one department. We love living here, and we appreciate all of our services. People buy property in this city based on the fact that the value will be high due to the great schools and services offered here. To me, it's only logical that there will be a price of slightly higher taxes for such services, but despite the tight nature of our personal household budget, my husband and I still see this as an investment that will pay us back for many years. Please support our community and approve a budget that does not cut positions or programs. Thank you.
Oh, excuse me one second. I noticed that there was a parent with whom I can relate greatly. I have two little girls, one that's almost one, one that's almost three, and it's about 7:45. That's a bad combination. And I could completely understand the situation that parent was in. If you are here with a child, or for that matter, if you're tired, we have right over here in Conference Room A, it's closed circuit, audio, you get the video, just like the folks at home would be watching. If you need some privacy, again, if you have a kid that's acting up a little bit, you can follow it from there as well. But if you're comfortable here, even better. Sorry about that.
If that applied to me, I can't hear it, Mayor Marchand. So, Mayor Marchand and members of the City Council, my name is Louise McGee, and I live at 1275 Maplewood Avenue. I was born here 84 years ago, and I hope to be able to die here, but that's getting more difficult to do. Many financial experts are warning us that we are in the direct path of the economic perfect storm. At the same time, this city is facing a confiscatory and astronomical budget full of all kinds of goodies for now and into the future. Many of us taxpayers have reached the breaking point. We've built a fine resort for everyone else to move to and benefit from with state-of-the-art provisions while allowing ourselves to be spent out of our homes. It is impossible for moderate incomes to handle the cost. Your responsibility rests not only with spending of our money, but in the safeguarding of it, recognizing it is not an inexhaustible resource, and showing consideration for those paying the bills while going broke. You are the only governmental body here which has bottom line control. It rests with you. I wouldn't even attempt to mini-manage the budget. I don't have that much information about it. You people do. Unless you want to preside at the final disposal of what remains of the Portsmouth native element, you will exercise the utmost restraint in adopting a budget this year. Not just judgment, but restraint to hold to a 0% increase. In a situation like this, it seems good sense to batten down the hatches and head for port. One of my old and prudent teachers used to quote to us, "A word to the wise is sufficient." Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Susan Chamberlain, and I live at 390 Greenleaf Ave. I'm here to testify in support of the school board's budget. And I'd like to emphasize that investing in the school is a community investment. One of the common themes that everyone has testified to is that we all want to live here, and that's a great thing. It's a great city. Unfortunately, the bad news about the schools often hits the paper, and that's what I read in the headlines. We read about the drug problems and the problems with the athletic department and the dropout rate. And I would like to remind everyone that if we don't pay for education now, we pay for it later. And that is, we pay for the GED for the kids in jail who haven't made it through high school, who haven't found a teacher they can relate to. The school board has given us a very straightforward path. This is what we need. We need money to fund these positions. This is what we need to do our job. These are reasonable requests. Small class size is reasonable. An athletic director is reasonable. I don't know the details of the rest of the budget. But when they say this is what we need to do the job, I believe them. I have a daughter. She's in kindergarten. I hope that she will go through the high school in Portsmouth. That's my plan. That's why we moved here. I'd like you all to keep that in mind, and I'm glad to hear that at least the mayor has kids in the schools, and we'll have a personal investment in keeping our high-quality education. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Mitch Schulman. I live at 620 Lincoln Avenue, and I am a new member of the Portsmouth School Board. I would like to just take a moment to point out that not only am I new, but 40% of the board is new, the assistant superintendent is new, the business administrator is new, and the superintendent is just finishing his first year. So one could possibly say it's a new day in the Portsmouth School Department. I realize I may be swimming against the tide, since it is my understanding that some on this council are prepared to cut serious money from the school department's budget request. Nevertheless, I'd like to share with you a few observations that I've made over just the past 5 months as a school board member. I've learned that there are people who really don't like teachers. They think teachers get paid too much money, don't work hard enough, have too many days off, and aren't held accountable. There are people who absolutely do not trust the Portsmouth School Department. There are members of this council who think the school district pads its budget, doesn't spend the taxpayers' money wisely, doesn't need any new teaching positions, in fact has too many teachers already, and can simply afford to do away with the 15 retiring teacher positions. There are some people who wouldn't mind seeing class sizes of 30 students or more. I've recently learned that only about 25% of taxpayers in Portsmouth have children in the schools, and I'm afraid that families may be in for budget cuts and budget battles for years to come as an older retiring demographic moves into the state. There are some people who think that because the school department has gone without in the past, that we can continue to do so in the future, and this is simply not so. There are also successes to celebrate as well. Briefly, the NECAP assessment tests, first year, which administrates the same test to all third through eighth grade students in New Hampshire, Vermont, and Rhode Island. Portsmouth students outperform the state averages in all three states across nearly all grades for students who achieved both proficient and proficient with distinction. My point is, money matters, and it matters more now than ever before because, in case you haven't noticed, the world has dramatically changed over the past 15 years. If we don't ensure that our children leave high school with the critical thinking abilities to make informed decisions and adapt to an ever-changing economy, they will simply find it more difficult to compete in a world where equally educated English-speaking citizens of other nations will gladly work just as hard for less. If you think your children will be able to buy homes in Portsmouth and live in Portsmouth by slashing education budgets in order to lower taxes, you are woefully mistaken. While we can't control the cost of living or the cost of housing, we can do our best to ensure that our children can afford to live here by giving them an education that develops their intellect and equips them with the skills to find good jobs. That will enable them to live here. There is a reason why the more fortunate in our society send their children to $50,000 a year Ivy League schools, because they know when it comes to education that money matters. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Patrick Ellis. I live at 235 McKinley Road. a Portsmouth resident for 11 and a half years now. Proud to have settled here and planning to stay here for the rest of my life, I hope. 2001, the state Claremont decision forced Portsmouth to give money to the state, and the city of Portsmouth had to ask the school board for drastic reductions to their budget, $1 million reduced from that budget. Interestingly enough, 2001 was the same year that No Child Left Behind was passed by Congress and signed by the president. In 2002, again, because of the Claremont decision, more cuts were asked to be made of the Portsmouth School Department, $650,000 in 2002. Those cuts were made by the school board in good faith. They knew that there was a situation, a dire crisis that had to be met by the city of Portsmouth. They made tough decisions. They've continued to make tough decisions since then. The reality of the situation is they eliminated middle management positions they felt that they could do without for a short period of time during the funding crisis. Those positions can't go on unfilled forever. Just as with a car, perhaps this month, if you don't have enough money, you can skip that oil change. If you skip the oil change long enough, you're buying a new car. That's what's happening with the athletic department, sans athletic director. That's what's happening with technology in our schools without a technology director. I asked the board to support the full budget. The school board has looked at what the needs are for the school system and determined that the positions that were cut 5 years ago need to be filled now. During the course of time since those cuts were made, No Child Left Behind has increased by law the requirements of the school system, but the school hasn't received the funding back to restore the programs that were cut. Please support the full budget. Thank you.
Good evening, Council. My name is Bob Brookhouse. I live at 5 Pheasant Lane in Portsmouth. I'm simply a taxpayer. I think we pay high taxes here. I'm concerned about it. I look at the budgets and the budget requests, and it kind of reminds me of being a church financial officer. There's an unlimited number of great ideas and good things to do, but there's limited resources. And I ask the council to look at the taxpayers as limited resources, not a bottomless pit. We look around and we see around us companies that we recognize the names of, whether it's IBM or Polaroid or a Kodak or a General Motors or the airlines. They've had to face some very difficult facts. They've had difficult parts to deal with, unions and healthcare programs and legacy systems and so forth. Some of them have made changes and they've been successful. They've been able to meet the challenges. Others have looked at things the same way they looked at them before and basically said, we have to do these things. And they failed. And they're not here. They're not doing anything. And I just simply ask the council to get outside the box a little bit and look at some of the issues that you're facing and some of the requests for more money. And look at them and try to do things differently so we don't have to keep paying higher and higher taxes. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. Bill St. Laurent, 253 Colonial Drive. It was mentioned that if we cut the budget, by cutting the school budget, that people are going to afford to live here. Well, I raised 4 children in Portsmouth, and 2 of them wish to live in Portsmouth and can't afford it. This goes back a few years. This isn't something that is happening right now. And if we continue to increase, not only my children, but a lot of people won't be able to live. A lot of families won't be able to stay in this town. Mayor Marchand mentioned that in the beginning of this that he had to be careful with the budget, so the balance of the budget, because if you have a high one and you cut it too low, it's going to affect different departments. Well, what's happening now is if you don't control this budget spending, it's going to affect future budgets. The more you The more money you spend now will never be enough because it'll always be more and more. The budgets are getting higher. The spending is out of control. The buck has to stop somewhere, and it really has got to be this year, because this could go on and on. We'll soon be spending tens of millions of dollars to make required upgrades to our water treatment facilities. On top of that, some level of capital will be needed to spend on our aging middle school and three elementary schools. The capital plan has us replacing two fire stations with brand new ones. With these large capital expenditures on the horizon, the general fund spending increase should be kept below the inflation rate to help make up for these large capital expenditures. I say we should keep it at a zero budget. There are towns throughout the country now that are cutting budgets. Some of them even fearing bankruptcy because of the bonding, the great amount of bonding that they're getting involved with. Bonding is nothing more than a credit card. The more you spend, the more you're going to have to pay. It may have your credit rating look pretty good, but you still have to spend that money. I represent also the Association of Portsmouth Taxpayers, and tonight there are people here, and if they want to stand, fine, that will not speak, but here to represent to keep the budget down. So that's what we're here as taxpayers to make sure that you control spending in this town. And I know it's a hard job. I've sat on your seat, but you have to do it. It's a fact of life now. It's going everywhere. Towns everywhere are having to cut back, and you can read it in the paper all the time. So please, please use some fiscal restraint and cut the spending in this town. Thank you.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor, City Manager, and City Council members. My name is John Bouchard. My wife and I reside at 150 FW Hartford Drive. We have a son in first grade at Don Darrell School. I am here tonight to support the budget that the school board has put in front of you. I am a parent and also a taxpayer in the city of Portsmouth. They are one in itself. I have a few points that I'd like to point out. Please remember, you are not running a corporation when giving an education to students in Portsmouth. Teachers can't pick who they want in their class and who they want to fire. They have to teach every student, and that means every student has different needs, which you need to have support for these children. That is the reason all the positions are requested. Point number two, I've attended some of your meetings, watched them on TV, and read a lot of the newspaper. And it seems there's a lot of negativity to the budget, but I don't hear a lot of positive comments from you on the budget. I can give you one fact that is true. I know you have received hundreds, if not thousands, of calls and letters that people that support the budget that is in front of you. So I would hope you hear our voices along with the negative ones. My last point, I think the classroom size has been beat to death, so let's put it to rest. You need to understand each class has different needs, and the teachers in Portsmouth deserve the respect that they know what each classroom size should be. They are the professionals. Let's let them teach our children and control the classroom sizes. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Andrea Ardito, and this is my daughter, Olivia Ardito. She goes to Little Harbor School. I stand before you, and it's hard for me to imagine the task that lay in front of you. So much of the budget forums have been wrought with an us-them dialogue. To get through that seems at times insurmountable, I'm sure. Yet there is always time to start again, to take a step back, a collective deep breath, and look with a different perspective on how to weave together our needs as a community, the whole community. I take the irrational stance that we must take care of each other, that we must care for each other in our community. I take the stance that we creatively think outside of the box so that we can take care of the needs for everyone in our community, that we do not adopt this us-them mentality, the assumed attitude, if you have children in the Portsmouth school system, that you must not care about the taxpayers of Portsmouth. We are one in the same. I stand here boldly saying that you must care for my child, your neighbor's child, a child you may never know playing on the playground. For if we care for each other, we care for ourselves. We give to each other, and in doing so, we give back to ourselves. We must not turn our back on our children and their education. I think often of a story a dear friend of mine once told me, and I'd like to share it with you. It is the story of a woman who is observing two rooms. In one room, there is a large table set out filled end to end with delicious, mouth-watering dishes, each one more tantalizing than the last. There is a group of people sitting around this table. They are hungry, starving, longingly looking at the food before them. Each person holds a very large, long spoon, so large that they cannot bring the spoon to their lips. Each time they try, the food just inevitably falls and spills to the ground, leaving the person to sit in despair. There is another room that the woman wanders into, though. In this room, there too is a large table set with the most amazing of dinners, food piled almost to the ceiling with wonderful smells filling the air. In this room, there is another group of people similar to the first, sitting around the table with the same long spoons. But this room is different. Laughter is heard. People are eating heartily, enjoying the great feast before them. There is no difference in the two rooms. Each room has the same foods, same long spoons laid before each guest. The sole difference in the second room, where the people were able to eat and goodwill flowed, was that instead of just trying to feed themselves, they chose to feed each other. We need to take care of each other. Please have the tough choices you must make tonight be led with a spirit of caring for our children. There is a Chinese proverb that says, "A child's life is like a piece of paper on which every person leaves a mark." It is my deepest hope that the mark you leave on our children is one that as a community we can all be proud of. Thank you.
My name is Maureen Donnelly, and I live at 41 Kensington Road, and I'm a Dondero parent and a taxpayer. And I'll be brief. Economists agree that the best measure of the health of our future economy is in our human capital, which is to say our children. When we decide, when we set out a budget, we not only say who we are, we say who we intend to be. I came to the last budget hearing, and I had planned to speak, but the tenor of the conversation was really troubling and confrontational, and I chickened out. And I'm speaking today because I understand why it was troubling, and I understand why it was so confrontational. These are really scary times. And according to that, I think we really need to make the least dangerous assumption and invest in our children. Level funding, I believe, is 6.1% for our schools. And I just want to end with, I heard the former Commissioner of Education, Nick Donahue, speak, and he said that he was sympathetic to people. We're saying, you know, you can't keep throwing money at the system. Money doesn't equal quality. But he said, let's just try it once and see what happens. I'm right behind him on that.
Hello, my name's Dryden Robertson. I live at 139 Sherburne Avenue. I've been a Portsmouth resident for 20 years. My daughter just finished her first year of college, and my son's a junior in the high school. We have had to move once to a smaller house because of costs, but it's not totally the taxes, it's the cost of the houses, which has gone up and up and up in the past 20 years. I've worked in special education since 1974. I've worked with children who are institutionalized, with adults who've been deinstitutionalized, and children who've stayed at home and gone to school. And I want to thank the Portsmouth school system because we include these children in our schools, and they can become self-supporting or partially supporting adults rather than drains on our society. And I think back to two students I had 30 years ago, who one is a software engineer. He designs and sells software. He has severe cerebral palsy. He drools nonstop. He has a tremor like this, and he is self-supporting. He drives his own van, and it's because we managed to get him into the local high school at that time. This was before public law, 94-142, I think it was. And the other child had severe hydrocephalus, and the doctors told her parents to institutionalize her, and now she is also self-supporting and lives very independently and has a family. And I think people forget that these children that we have are going to grow up and become adults, whether we give them the education they need or not. And I think these two children could have cost the taxpayers thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars if they had been institutionalized as was recommended. And at this point, I believe it would be like over $100,000 a year to institutionalize a child and to tuition a child to another district. So I want to speak in support of the budget because I think it's important for these children who will become adults. Thank you.
My name's Dexter Legg. I live at 846 Middle Street. I've been a resident of Portsmouth for 25 years. I'm speaking in favor of a full-time athletic director for the Portsmouth High School. Now, I understand your role as city council is to set budgets, not to determine specific line items. Spending those budgets wisely is the job of the department heads. But it seems some are unwilling to fix a school athletic program that fundamentally is broken. So I'm asking you to send a message that a full-time athletic director is integral to effective leadership and must be included in this year's budget. School-sponsored programs are as critical to the education of our children as classroom instruction. Indeed, the best performing schools academically in New Hampshire have a wide array of quality and programs, including athletics. That's no coincidence. These districts understand the value these programs offer in teaching lifelong skills. Skills such as commitment to common goals, teamwork, sacrifice, dedication that often are not found in our classrooms. But doing so requires leadership, and for athletics, that means a full-time athletic director. We've tried a part-time position, we've tried a shared position. None have succeeded, not necessarily because of the person in the job, but because how the job was structured. This isn't the time for more half measures. Just think of the leverage of this position. Hundreds of student athletes participate on dozens of teams throughout the school year. The athletic director is responsible for hiring, supervising, and developing over 50 coaches, and its reach is well beyond sports. Athletics arguably is the most visible program in the school systems. Newspapers write about sports every day, and student athletes are the most immediate representatives of Portsmouth as they travel to away games. A quality athletic program can set the tone of excellence and accomplishment for the entire school system. Unfortunately, right now, ours highlights mediocrity and failure. So I strongly urge you to fund a full-time athletic director position. And more broadly, I encourage you to continue working towards improving our school system. While I don't fully support every line item in the school budget, I am willing to pay higher property taxes for better schools. My employer, Liberty Mutual, confronts the same issue you do. Education is costly. We invest a lot in training people because we are a highly service-oriented company. Unfortunately, in far too many circumstances, we lose those trained employees to our competitors. So we debate the incredible expense of loss and value when such great financial investment walks out the door. We resolve the conflict of investing and losing trained employees by asking ourselves, which would we rather, to have well-trained employees who sometimes leave or untrained employees who stick around? And the benefit of training are far greater than having a workforce that delivers great service. Ultimately, quality education creates people in a company that faces competition in the future with optimism. So we at Liberty continue to invest heavily, and I would encourage you to do the same. Not every graduate of Portsmouth High School will stick around. But for those who do, surely we should want them highly educated and able to meet the future challenges of our city with hope and optimism. That education must include more than classroom instruction. Regardless of the final amount approved for the schools, we need a full-time athletic director now, and I urge you to support this position. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, Councilman, my name is Warren Goddard. I live at 8 Wilson Road, Portsmouth. I haven't, like most people, I haven't studied the budget in detail. In fact, I haven't studied it at all. But one matter has come to my attention concerning the budget and the spending of taxpayers' money, I mean. That is small money-wise, but huge in principle. I'm told, and I know, the city of Portsmouth pays for the health insurance of its employees, a very beneficial health program, better than most in industry. I've heard the figure $18,000. I don't know if that's right or not. Maybe it's $20,000. But it pays for the health of the employee and his immediate family. However, the issue is that if there are two people in the family, you would think that the city could have the health care for the family for both employees for the $18,000 or $20,000. And save the city a little money. But actually, I'm told that the $18,000 or $20,000 for the second employee isn't paid to the insurance company because they don't need it. It's paid to the new employee. They get the cash. I find this outrageous. It's a total ripoff on the taxpayers. True. I might be wrong, true, but you might check it out. And if this is reflective of other things in the budget, I would support a zero increase budget. Thank you.
Mayor, this is out of the norm, but would you have the city manager?
Yeah, we were.
Thank you. Thank you very
well,
much.
If he would step away from the mic.
Any questions?
No. I appreciate your comment, but I know the city manager was just going to make, I think, one brief, I believe, correction to the some information that was presented. Yeah, we're not looking to go back and forth because, no offense, it sets a precedent where why couldn't the next five people have.
Well, I said this came to my attention. Sure. I don't know whether you know about it or not, but if you know about it, it is an outrage. I'd be outraged that you're not outraged.
I think the gentleman was somewhat misinformed. The city does provide health insurance to employees. Those that are single, there's a rate that is paid. Those for two people, and then a family plan. City employees within the 15 collective bargaining agreements pay approximately 18% premium share on the rates that are provided to the city through the local government trust, which we utilize as our health care insurer, which is basically Blue Cross Blue Shield. With regards to the amount that is paid for someone that chooses not to take the plan, there is, I believe, two collective bargaining agreements, if I'm not mistaken, and I know the Human Resource Director is here, and she can correct me if I'm wrong. But how many collective bargaining agreements are there, Diana, that have that? But they are. Why don't you come up and speak to the issue?
Well, it needs to be clarified.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
All the municipal collective bargaining agreements, which are. Sorry.
Of all the municipal bargaining agreements, 8 of them, there is some language in there to encourage employees who don't take the health insurance costs. There is an incentive. It could be one, the police department pays $111.06 a quarter to the employees who do not choose to take the health insurance.
So, for example, Diana, that would mean annually they...
$444.24 a year.
As opposed to them taking a full single plan.
Right, which is around, to the city, is about $6,400.
In savings.
So, there's two other groups that pay $1,000 a year, $250 a quarter, and there's another group that pays 50% of the cost of the plan. So they have different incentives,
so,
depending on what they bargained.
So basically, if people do opt out of a plan, in most instances, there's substantial savings for the city.
Correct.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And that was out of the norm in terms of that, and appreciate the information. But basically, I think there, some of the information may have been somewhat, there may have been some misinformation there in terms of information given to the speaker. And then we just want to make sure, because the magnitude of the difference is large enough that it's probably worth a few minutes. So. Hopefully, I appreciate your patience on that one, and appreciate your patience in line.
I'll wait as long as it takes to get some real facts out. I'm Robert Padian, 312 Cabot Street. When the last election was going, people were talking about the budget. I asked all the candidates if they had to save, I forget what number I used, 100,000, 10,000, what specific line item would they cut from the city budget? The two most specific were, fortunately, none of you gave them. They're behind me in the crowd. One would cut the overtime for the fire department, and the other would cut the building in the middle school. The first one is inevitable, and the second one is not in the operating budget. That is the level of a lot of the back and forth on this. There are a couple of things that I think hold true for budgeting. First, you want to hit the jackpot, you got to put some nickels in the machine. And second, the only activity that benefits from throwing money at it is lighting a fire when you've run out of kindling. We have to come somewhere in between. The worst part of this process is I have no idea what I would cut, except from some things that have annoyed me for years, and strictly because they've annoyed me. Do we need an athletic director? Good question. Do we need a football team? Better question. Do we need a French teacher? That's where you're getting down to the nitty-gritty. What do we need from the schools? What do we need from the police department? Can we trim the national night out? Can we trim a lot of the secondary activities that add a little bit, perhaps, in overtime and an awful lot in pension? Can we stop paving streets? Well, mine was done recently, so I'm easy with that. But you know what will happen next year. What are the line items, what are the priorities that each of these departments have come up with? And unless we know that, you might as well pick a number out of a hat and give it to each budget and say, you're off 5%, you're off 10%. Let's see what you can do with what's left. And let's see who switches into reality mode. And if you're going to improve the process, I'd say you need a budget commission that is composed not of people who are preparing the budget, nor those who will be direct beneficiaries of the budget, but some citizens who can look at all of the line items and say, why did you put that there? I don't know if it makes sense or not. Why is it there? Can we sort these? Can we match them across the board? And then maybe when we come here, we'll be able to say, yeah, we've got to have that. We've got to have some give and take. And people in general can say, these things are the most important we have to do. And the alternative is you'll be back at this time and again saying, not my ox this time, gore somebody else. Thank you.
Tough act to follow. Good evening, Mayor, Council members. Thank you very much. My name is Eric Anderson. I'm from 38 Georges Terrace in Portsmouth. Times are changing. The issues that you're dealing with today are, granted, not the same as what the past was. I was here early, and I just happened to look at the picture out in the foyer of the working waterfront of Portsmouth. Five of the seven vessels in the picture are gone. This community is changing. Its texture is changing. Its people are changing. Its dynamics are changing. Your problems and the issues that you have to face with regards to this budget, I think, have to be summarized in some respect. I've tried to go through that budget on a number of occasions, only just to accumulate some facts and I think some figures. 83% of your budget is personnel. 11% of it's bonding. There's 94%. You don't have a lot to play with. But in the same respect, when's enough is enough. I took particular interest in some of the insurance, you know, the items that was discussed with insurance. Why do we have to reimburse an employee at all if he does not elect to take an insurance plan? I just don't understand that. Up to 50% in one department of the premium minus is 18%. Generally, the premiums in this, you know, through the insurance premiums for all the departments run between, I mean, I did it, $19,000 to $13,000 a year per employee, and it ranges between departments, which I found a little bit, you know, mystifying. There is some issues within that budget that kind of gripe me or bring attention, just kind of light up. You have one department with 60 employees that have $623,000 in overtime. That's you have another department with 91 employees with $449,000 in overtime. Collectively, that's over $1 million in overtime in this city. Collectively, all through the rest of the department, collectively, overtime is about $1.4 million. And two departments make up over $1 million of it. I think this has to be looked at. I think the city got shortchanged in some respect in some of the collective bargaining decisions that took place with the negotiations of these contracts. And I think to look at it in the future, hopefully it might be a more public process, with people and the taxpayers participating in the conversation, because ultimately that is where the money is going to come from to pay for these contracts. And I attended some of the public, I attended some of the work sessions. I found them, you know, informative. I hope in the future that you might be able to change the dynamics of it so that there is more public participation in that. If people want to show up, they shouldn't be just, you know, gag and bound to just listen through those work sessions. Maybe they might have some constructive comments. I think as a council, you've heard a variety of comments. Plenty of them are good with regards to a whole range of issues. I think there is an obligation of the council I have just a few more minutes. I thought I was one of the last speakers for the first round.
Well, one thing, again, trying to be consistent, is we do have two more rounds, so, and it appears that there aren't too many in the first round. Feel free to stick around.
Back to the line, end of the line. Thank you.
Great, thank you.
My name is Carol McGinty, and I reside at 300 Spinney Road. I was raised in the city of Portsmouth and educated in the Portsmouth school system. Up until 5 years ago, I lived in a much smaller community where I paid approximately one-tenth of the taxes that I pay now. After running a business in that town for 4 years, I realized I truly got what I paid for, a second-rate school system. I had students working for me that were ranked in the top 10% of their class. These students were highly motivated and self-disciplined. They went on to college only to fail within their first semester. I came to realize that I was living in a community that did not value its education. I came to realize that in order to get a quality education for my son, I needed to move back to Portsmouth. We did not base this decision on my education, but based it on the many successes of my numerous nieces and nephews who attended the Portsmouth school system. These kids went on to George Washington University, Johnson & Wales, and Wentworth Institute in Boston, to name a few. These kids did not get there by chance. It happened because of the dedication and hard work of the numerous teachers in the Portsmouth school system. Please support the school budget so that my son and the many others in his age group may have the same opportunities in his education as the many that have come before him. Thank you.
Good evening. My name's Louise Dupree. I live at 300 FW Hartford Drive in Portsmouth. Tonight, I wish to speak to you on behalf of the school department in your charge in deciding how much money to give them. My request to you is simple. The decision as to what the school administration will actually do with the amount you give them seems very complex. I ask you tonight, when you send the school board their budget, to please recommend or give your opinion, of which I believe is within your legal abilities, to support a full-time qualified and experienced athletic director at the high school. The road to the girls' lacrosse state finals last night in Manchester was the roughest road I have ever experienced in its four-year history. We barely made it there, not because of how the players played or the games that were won or lost, but because of the lack of leadership in athletics at the high school. I have a signature sheet with 143 signatures. This was basically the effort of one person in 3 days without really trying. These 143 people would be happy to share with you the same bumps in the road. They support a full-time qualified and experienced AD and have shared their bumps with many school board members and Dr. Lister. 500 plus student athletes are without leadership at Portsmouth High School. Please support this request and recommend a support for funds for an AD at Portsmouth High School. It's not what they want, it's what they need. Thank you for listening.
Kristen Loeb, 536 Middle Road, Portsmouth.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear your name.
Kristen Loeb, L-O-G-U-E, 536 Middle Road.
Thank you.
I started working in Portsmouth in 1978 at RMC Research down on Bow Street when they were down there. Back then, on an entry-level position, I could rent an apartment on Sagamore Ave, purchase a new car, and live pretty comfortably. Paying mortgage forward ahead to 2006, paying mortgage taxes, utilities, community costs, has gotten way out of hand. I'm asking you to please cut this budget fairly reasonably across departments. I can't go to my employer and say, here's what I need to maintain my current quality of life. Here's what my needs and wants are. Even if I say it's for the children, I probably get 2 to 3% if I meet my goals for the year. I think I represent middle-class Portsmouth. We're two technicians with one school-aged child. We're falling behind every year. If you continue passing these budgets such as this, you won't have to worry about a middle class. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Santhi Gray. I live at 251 South Street. I am a parent and I am a taxpayer. And I'd just like to say that I'm frightened by what could happen potentially if the major cuts are made to the school budget. I'm frightened for my child's education. And I would just strongly urge you to invest in our children and support the school budget that's been proposed. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lisa Sweet from 259 Miller Avenue. I'm here to advocate for responsible funding of all city budgets. Some of you may know me as an advocate for the schools, but I'd also like to commend the other city departments for jobs well done on a regular basis. And I can tell you, when we had a major emergency not too long ago, the timely and thorough response of the police, fire, and public works departments was much appreciated. As an educator, a parent, and a taxpayer, I strongly believe that strong, healthy public schools are the ultimate sustainability play. Please know that from 1999 to 2004, the state average cost per pupil rose by 41%. Portsmouth's per pupil expense rose by only 21% during that time. Doing more with less has already happened here. Doing less with less is just simply unwise. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Laurie Rosa. I live at 264 Leslie Drive in Portsmouth. I have three children in the Portsmouth Community School System. I'm a Little Harbor parent, a Portsmouth Middle School parent, and a Portsmouth High School parent. And I came here today to thank you very much for the education my children have received thus far. We have consumed about 26 combined years of Portsmouth public education, and we have 12 more years to go for my three kids. And I can tell you the education they've received is outstanding. I feel my children are prepared to go on and enter higher degrees of education and develop skills that will serve them in our future marketplaces. And I can tell you, compared to many other school systems in other parts of this country, this is far superior. And our children are much more prepared to not only serve this community in many jobs that you will need in the future, but they will go beyond that. And I just wanted to thank you and remember that as you're preparing your budget, and that I do support the budget for this year's school. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Natalie Hassold. I live at 15 Mount Vernon Street, and I also have a business downtown, so I pay taxes in two places. But I just wanted to point out that I also have what I sometimes consider a personality defect based on my astrological sign, which is Libra, and that is that I can see both sides and all sides of all questions. I truly believe that we need to provide the best possible education that we can for our children. Many of you and your children are my friends and neighbors, and I totally support your issue. The police and fire department need new technology. You know, we have all kinds of new concerns that cost us a lot of money in our budget. On the other side of that coin is that we're all being stretched really tightly, and we need to hold our city's budget to a reasonable place. And I know you guys can do it. It's very hard for all of us to assess each individual item. You know, you need to be educated on each issue to be able to comment on it intelligently. But that's why we elected you guys, and I know you're going to study it, and I would ask that you please have some restraint so that we can all get the services that we need. Thank you.
My name is Karen Goldberg. I live at 240 Broad Street. I moved here 2 years ago from California, where although taxes were increasing, the quality of education was going down. And one of our main priorities when moving was to look at education. And we look at class size. We looked at pupils, per pupil spending. We looked at test scores. And that is why we chose Portsmouth. That is why we chose to come here and pay even higher taxes than we paid in California. And I just think that those numbers matter. They matter for families moving into Portsmouth. They're looking at those numbers. What I found at Little Harbor was more than numbers. What I found was a community that cared about each other, students, teachers, administrators, parents, all working together. It's an incredible school system, and I think we should do anything we can to continue to support it. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. Leslie Stevens, 151 Park Street. I have three children in the school district here, two at Little Harbor and one in the middle school. And by now, I hope that you've all seen this. This is a postcard that the PTAs, PTOs, and PTSA here in Portsmouth came up with. And I'd like to just read it to you. Hopefully, you all checked your mailbox tonight. And if you didn't, you should, because hopefully there's a bunch of them in there. And I know some of them came in the mail. But what we wrote, hopefully, you know, it'll make sense to you all. Dear City Councilor, I'm a Portsmouth resident, and in many cases a taxpayer, who supports successful schools and values quality education for all students. Please support a school department budget that will not result in cuts in staff or programs. And I just want to reiterate how important this is. And please check your mailboxes, and hopefully they're coming to you in your mail as well. And thank you. I appreciate all the work you're doing.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, city staff. Martin Cameron, 469 Ocean Road. I don't have any kids in school. They finished up, I think, around 82, and they're all doing well. And I went to the Portsmouth Listens exercise a week ago or so, and that was very informative. Enjoyed it a lot. I think both sides, or as many sides as possible, on, no matter what side of the issue we were on, everybody seemed to gain something out of it. And it was a very worthwhile exercise, and I would imagine it's going to continue. But during the exercises, some items came up, and one was on the school budget. It concerned, is that we talked about, okay, there are 15 teachers going to retire this year, and there are 15 teachers are going to be replace them one-on-one. No problem with that. However, a member of the school board said they wanted to hire 17 additional teachers. So I have a problem with that. I said, well, how long, what's this need for all of a sudden, 17 new teachers? I said, well, we wanted to get them a few years back, 3 or 4 years maybe, but the budget was cut, so we couldn't get the teachers during the last 3 or 4 years. Well, I just happened to find some old budget sheets here, and I said, I don't remember the school budget being cut. But, you know, in politics and so forth, cut has many meanings in a budget. If a department requests $10 million and it's their last year's operating budget was $9 million, and the figure was cut from the $10 million requested down to $950, that is referred to as cut. Although it was $50,000 extra or whatever, $500,000 added to it. So the word cut has many meanings in budgets, especially municipal and state and federal. But I know a speaker came up here earlier in the meeting, and he said that they wanted these teachers back around, said the budget in 2001, and so in that time frame. Well, let me go back in that time frame. 1990, Pease closed. The city population of Portsmouth went from 26,000 down to 20,000. The school population dropped 1,000, okay? So then they came up then in 2001, and I remember some conversation there about there was going to be drastic cuts in the school teachers and so forth, and I think the city came out and said, no, we're going to be able to meet most of the cuts with attrition and so forth. So there were no really large-scale cuts. So I see my time is up here, but I'm going to continue into this same program, plus maybe one or two other items. I think we'll find some of it interesting, I hope. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Helen Steele, and I live at 53 Praise Street in Portsmouth. Earlier this evening, one of the speakers came up and said that economically, Portsmouth is in the path of the perfect storm. With this in mind, I urge you not to make your budgetary decisions in a vacuum. Realize that inflated budgets for cities across the country have been the norm for over 10 years. Realize that these budgets are causing cities across the country to lose their good bond rating, and in some cases, they face bankruptcy. Bankruptcy in a city is a horrible, horrible thing. The retirements that we're fighting for, the wages, everything else is gone. This is serious. Realize that heyday of just granting budgets, whatever is requested, is over. I urge you to vote a 0% budget increase and be the force that puts Portsmouth back on track. Thank you.
Britt Conway, 4 Suzanne Drive. I'm a proud member of the girls' varsity lacrosse team. I also played varsity soccer and varsity basketball. Dr. Lister, Mr. Zadravec, Mr. Parr, and Mr. Huebner all tried so hard this year to make up for the lack of leadership in the athletic department. We also had help from parents and coaches, but the fact is it wasn't enough. We really need someone in the athletic department full-time to help the students out. Thank you.
And thank you for an awfully successful season. I think that might deserve a little round of applause separately. Hopefully this won't incur boos after all that nice applause, but we'd really like a 5-minute break before we go into a second round. I hope you'll appreciate the dynamics to go into that need. So let's do it again. Let's try to keep it at 5. We will start just before 10 of 9 for second round. Thank you.
Line up for a second round.
Okay. We are back. And appreciate everybody's indulgence there, a few-minute break. Everybody's refreshed for a second time around. So whether you've spoken before this evening or you haven't, obviously get every right to speak for up to 3 minutes. We'll also have a third round. But if there's anybody here, whether they've spoken before or have not spoken prior this evening, who wishes to speak in the second time around, this would be a good time to do so. And if there are multiple people that come up, if you could queue up like you did before, that seemed to work pretty well. So feel free to come on up if you have something to say second time around. Come on down.
Hi, good evening. We ready?
There we go.
Okay. I did get a little added information there at the with the P's closing. We didn't make it all on the teachers with just attrition. There were 100, I guess, that were riffed. So the attrition wouldn't handle that mass exodus of 1,000 students. However, as we go into the budgets where we come up with, say they were budget cuts, I have here, this is the city's copy of, goes back to the fiscal year 2001 and 2 budget. Okay, on the school department, for instance, their budget there for fiscal year 2001 and 2, it was $25 million. This is the final figure, $25,486,887. The next budget for the years 2 and 3, it was $26,251,496. So basically, no cut there. The next year, 3 and 4, it was $26,774,456. So there was an increase there of approximately $500,000. No cut in that one. So then the budget for 4 years, 4,005 for the school was. Final was $29,184,157. So in those years there from 2001 up to 2005, I have last year's in here someplace, but that was also an increase. There were no cuts in the actual budget. There might have been a cut from what they had requested or what they desired, but as far as a definite cut in the budget, no. So we just, I'd like to settle that down. Okay, I think that'll cover that end of it. So with the request for the 17 teachers, new additional, I look at it like if, and I talked this over with the school board people. If you get along fine, you had no problems in the school system with the teachers you had on hand without the 17. The standards didn't go down, nothing went down, and as far as I hear people talking here tonight, teachers and so forth, they say the Portsmouth school system is superior to all the schools around the country. So if the standards and so forth didn't go down and you have classes with as low pupil attendance as, say, 6 to 10, and though I understand some other classes are a lot higher, maybe 18 and 20 and so forth, I can't see how you can justify a request for 17 more. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is Patrick Ellis from 235 McKinley Road. I just want to try to, as the previous speaker did, set the record straight. There are many definitions of cuts. In this case, the cuts that I was referred to earlier were cuts in services. The 0% increase to the budget in 2001 resulted in a cut of services, not in the cut of the budget. The following year, cost of inflation for contracted increases in salaries and health insurance, which neither the school board nor the city council had control over, required additional retractions because the mandatory increases, the mandatory increases resulted in, from those CPI increases, it resulted in additional cuts. Please support the school budget as requested. The teachers here do a fantastic job, but they are stretched thin by the requirements of No Child Left Behind, which is, for the most part, an unfunded mandate put down by the federal government. I encourage everyone here, both the city council and the attendees at the public hearing, to talk to our representatives and ask for them to fund that mandate that required all these services by law in the schools. Those are the services that a school are looking to meet now, and that's why they're asking for these positions. Thank you.
Eric Anderson, 38 Georges Terrace, Portsmouth, New Hampshire. Just like to continue where I left off. It is my belief that I think the council should hold a hard line, a conservative line, with the budget issues that it has in front of them. And I hope that they might be able to look at, you know, it's a case of what to do here. And hopefully whether it's even, you know, a prospect, as I think because of, you know, 83% of the budget is held up in, or is wrapped up in personnel issues, whether it's time to go back to the collective bargaining units that comprise that 83% and see if they want to show a spirit of cooperativeness to concede on some of the issues that are, I guess right now, contractual obligations, whether they want to concede on some of the CPI issues, whether they want to concede on some of the health benefit issues, whether they want to concede wherever they can be creative enough to show a spirit of cooperation with, I think, an issue that's very contentious. So I don't know whether that has the possibilities of a solution, but at least it would show a spirit of cooperation amongst all parties, amongst the people that advocate for, you know, the educational aspects of it, and people that advocate for no budget increases at all, is to bring other players in, bring the players in that are consuming the budget, and hopefully that might create some type of prospect for conceding. I think it's relatively unreasonable for the citizens of Portsmouth to bear the potential increases that are coming forward, and you know it's time to start thinking that their pocketbooks are the bank here, and how far can you go? Thank you very much.
Second time around, Bob Hassel, 15 Mount Vernon Street. I don't know which is worse, the weather in this area or the taxes. But at least we do get a break in the weather once in a while, but we're not getting a break in the taxes. So please try to remember that I have my own health insurance to pay, my taxes on my business in town, my taxes on my home, the rising cost of everything going on, including gasoline. I have no perks. I'm asking you, please, to hold the line. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Janine Moran. I live at 401 Greenleaf Avenue. And I'm a bit of a rarity in Portsmouth, apparently. I grew up here, went to school here, live here now, and work here, and pay taxes. I have a child at Dondera School in first grade. I have one that will next year be in kindergarten. My son, my first grader, is not a great reader, but he is the beneficiary of a reading program, that has been amazing for him. He's learned how to read faster than I ever thought humanly possible, considering where he started. And this could be one of those programs that if you cut the budget
as much as people would like you to cut the budget that may be cut, and other kids who have the same reading problems won't benefit like he did. So please, please support the school budget.
Hi, I'm Joanne Adenolfi. I live at 416 Stennett Street. And my son also benefited from that program. He started in first grade just being able to read and now he's reading chapter books that are at a second grade, 8 month level. And so I support the school budget. And I did also want to say that one way the city can save money is I live on Dennis Street, and when there's not even eighth an inch of snow on the ground, they're going back and forth and back and forth. And I think we know how to drive in an eighth of an inch of snow. So there's a tip for you.
Thank you, Mayor Michon, City Council members and staff. Peter Bresciano, 101 O'Leary Place. I, too, would like to see my taxes lowered. But at what price? What price and services do we see that happen? I have not heard anybody get up here and give specifics tonight on what they would like to see cut in the budget. I'll give you a couple of specifics. How about eliminating trash pickup, curbside trash pickup. We don't need it. I go to the recycling, or what I like to call the dump. I go to the dump at least twice a week, so I don't need curb pickup. So let's eliminate that. You could save, $200 a year? A family, they could take that and try to hire a private contractor to come pick up their trash. May take a little bit more money than that, but then it's a cut. We don't need it. How about let's cutting the capital improvement plan, so the next time we have a New England flood, we can really be in serious trouble, because we let our infrastructure just go to hell. It's easy to cut. Let's cut the $1 million out of the capital improvement and lose how many more millions from somebody else that's going to give us money because we've got such a high capital improvement budget. It's free money, but let's not take it. Let's cut that program. You know, a speaker got up here and talked about the overtime budget, or the overtime this year. Well, golly, you guys are the ones that jumped right on that bandwagon and got a study done. And I could have come down here, stood here, and told you the same thing that guy told you. But we spent $60,000 on overtime to find that there's no smoking gun in overtime. The fire department, the police department, they're telling the truth. Golly. Maybe we ought to take the four trash pumps away from the fire department. We could save money. They wouldn't have to make calls to the residents to pump out their cellars. I mean, how far do we go? Yet. How quickly we forget that just a few years ago, when I came up here every single city council meeting and railed about the statewide property tax, where was everybody? Why weren't they railing about the state property tax? $11 million we sent up there. You got to really take a hard look at the budget. School department, go back. Citizens, residents, read the unfunded needs portion in the budget book for the school department, especially the library. Thank you.
Okay. Before we go to third time around, there is a letter that if the city clerk would mind reading it that was submitted in lieu of attendance.
To the Mayor, City Council, and City Manager of Portsmouth, New Hampshire, please hold the line on any tax increase. I believe the city spending has gone crazy over the past 10 years or so, putting an unnecessary financial burden on the residents of this city. Holding the line on taxes would keep people employed and ease the financial burden on the residents of Portsmouth. I believe the majority of the people of Portsmouth feel the same over this matter. Hopefully, you will act favorably on this request. Thank you. Respectfully, Arthur D. Simone, city resident and taxpayer.
Thanks very much. We will move on to third and final time around. Anybody who is either, whether you've spoken or not this evening. So I apologize, didn't mean to jump the gun there. So come on up.
Hello. Does this work? Hello. My name is Sandy Carver Ergen, and I live at 251 Walker Bungalow Road. I'm a parent of two young boys, one entering third grade and one entering kindergarten. I'm also a former teacher. As you consider cutting the budget, I'd like you to keep in mind that these children, our future leaders, taxpayers, and residents, are shaped by their childhood experiences in the classroom right now. They spend 6 hours a day with their peers and their educators, the people who inspire, guide, and teach them. No matter how talented and dedicated a teacher may be, there are two critical factors in being an effective and successful teacher: great leadership and small class sizes. We are blessed at Little Harbor School in having truly exceptional leadership with Robin Burdick. However, class size is a serious issue that can spiral if the budget is cut. My son is in a second grade classroom with 21 students. I volunteer weekly to support his teacher, a wonderful educator who must juggle a spectrum of abilities and needs. It seriously worries me the direction our schools are heading if we don't make class size a priority. From experience, I can tell you that over time, a teacher teaches differently with more children in the classroom. If you don't, you burn out. You just can't be as creative, and learning can't be as meaningful. Often more traditional teaching and rote memorization prevails just by sheer space constrictions and classroom management issues. A teacher will end up spending more time disciplining and less time teaching. It's harder to make meaningful connections with students because one-on-one is nearly impossible. A child can fall more easily between the cracks or not be challenged because their teacher has just too many students. Please think carefully about your decision. Our children, our future citizens, depend on you to be their advocate for their learning and development. Believe in them. And when it's their turn to make meaningful decisions in our future, they will believe in us. Thank you.
Patrick Ellis, 235 McKinley Road. I hope to not ramble quite so much this time around. This will be my last chance to address the council tonight. I'd like to say that I support the budget of all the departments tonight. I think it's also safe to say that all the departments welcome your oversight and the oversight of the citizens of this city. Having sat in many of the work sessions for the school department, I know that money is not being hidden in that budget, that they're trying to address the needs of the students. And I have faith in the other departments that they're doing the same thing. If people question their sincerity when they say that the budget is what they need to perform the services that we've asked them to provide, sit in on those meetings and find the line items that need to be changed. Find out where money can be saved. Maybe money can be saved. Maybe new ideas need to be brought to the table. There's nothing wrong with new ideas. People aren't suggesting that we don't try something new and different. But what we're suggesting is that the people that we have put into a position to make these decisions on behalf of our students or on behalf of the infrastructure of the city, these are decisions they believe to be needed for this city. Please support the budget.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Holly Lasher from 53 Prey Street in Portsmouth. I've been listening to people talk about the size of classes, and I think about my privileged past in elementary school from kindergarten through eighth grade. Private schools, Fairfield County, Connecticut, the best of the best. And we had one of the smaller classes. We had 25 people for 9 years. We all went on to good schools, good colleges. Connecticut College for Women at the time was one of the tops. One of my classes had 158 students in it, one teacher. I really don't understand, other than the fact that sometimes there are students in a class who are there from special ed who need special services, but those services are brought into the classroom. What is wrong that someone can't teach more than 10 or 12 people at a time? 25 people, we knew them all. The teachers knew us all. We were well behaved. Someone, please help these teachers learn how to teach children. Thank you. Bigger groups of children than, say, a little group of 7 or 8. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Lucy Salyer, and I live at 1 Cane Street. I wasn't planning on speaking tonight, but I had to in response to the last comment. I don't think we're talking about teachers who don't know how to teach. I think we're talking about, on the whole, not everybody does a great job, I'm sure, but on the whole, my experience has been very positive with our school system. I think our teachers are dedicated public servants as well as employees. I think they deserve our support. I have a son who's in high school and a daughter who's in fourth grade at New Franklin. Been very impressed, especially given that they do a job that is very difficult and increasingly difficult, especially given the federal mandate for the Leave No Child Behind. I encourage you to support the requested school budget, to give our teachers the support and our administrators the support they deserve. I support the public servants of all the city of Portsmouth. I understand nobody likes to pay more taxes, and I totally understand that. But I think we really owe our public servants our support as well. They are not doing this as volunteer work. They are employees who are very well trained, and I think they deserve our support. Thank you.
Hi, Lisa Sweet again. An earlier comment on class size keeps coming up in my head. I think you probably do all know that you can't look at a course catalog and determine a teacher's student load. I'm not exactly sure how it's done at Portsmouth High School, but I know when I was teaching in Cambridge, Massachusetts, it was probably five sections of Algebra 1 and 2 with, I don't know, 20, low 20s. And then once a day, I had a math lab with probably 12 to 15 kids. In that math lab, the kids met once a week in that math lab for more individualized attention. So my workload was, you know, 4 or 5 times 20 to 25 plus 1 times the 10 to 15. So I would just encourage you to trust the school board or the administrators when you ask them about class size and not look at a course catalog and assume that there's a self-contained classroom with 5 kids at the high school. Thank you.
Peter Bresciano, just a short comment. As to class size, I can remember back when Pease was in full operations, and we had German 4 with maybe 3 students, and nobody complained. Nobody complained. And why? Because the bucks weren't coming out of everybody's pocket in Portsmouth. The feds were paying for that stuff. Now that we have small classes with six people in a class, it's coming out of our pockets. So we're going to have people complaining. You can't have it both ways. Yes, maybe there are cuts that need to be made in the school department budget. But there also are things like the athletic director that needs to be put back in there. Not only because people don't understand that the athletic director not only schedules high school sports programs, they have to schedule, before school lets out, the athletic fields so that the Babe Ruth, senior Babe Ruth can play on it, the Legion can play on it, the Legion can have their practices on it, the Seacoast Adult Baseball League can play on it. There's a lot of work that needs to be done by the athletic director that hasn't been done in the last couple of years, and I know personally because I get involved in it. Maybe our teachers need to go back and only teach the three R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. And forget about the rest of that stuff and let the parent do that, which is not happening now. I'm not saying in all cases, but it seems like teachers do spend a lot of time talking about other things than the three R's. And in closing, I'd just like to say I had two children that went through most of the Portsmouth school system because they were military brats and they had education other places. But they went on to, my son went on to New Hampshire Technical Institute. My daughter went to Keene State and the Rochester Institute of Technology. And they both could not have done that without a good education. Thank you.
Leslie Stevens, 151 Park Street. Oh, I just want to tell you a little story about my son's first grade class. I go in and volunteer in the classroom. There are 15 students in the classroom. There are several students in that classroom that started off the year being able to write full sentences, being able to make all their letters, being able to read. There were many students in that classroom who couldn't even form their own letters. And one little boy I watched one day, when he asked me how to spell my, I said M, and he went A, B, C, D, all the way until he got to M, and then he had to follow the arrows on his sheet to figure out how to make his M. So there were two boys over here writing stories and reading, and there was a little boy who started at A and had to find his M. Because there were 15 kids in that classroom, the teacher was able to address those two boys who could read and write, and that one little boy who needed to start at A to find his M. With 21, 22, 23 students in that class, she would teach to those 16 kids in the middle, and those two kids over here and that one little boy over here would get lost in the shuffle. So these boys are bored, and this little boy is lost. With 23 students in that classroom, that would be very hard for them. That's called differentiated instruction, and that's what our teachers do remarkably well. I ask you to keep our class sizes reasonable, not small, reasonable class sizes. Thank you.
Eric Anderson, 38 Georges Terrace, Portsmouth. The debate or the comments, I think, have been interesting. But the thing that kind of is eluding here is that we keep hearing the word cut, 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 cut. A cut, as far as I could interpret it, is if you took the last year's budget and you cut it to a lesser amount. All we're asking, I think the reasonable comments that are being made here, is that you just hold down the increases, minimize the increases that you're probably going to have to make to some respect, but just keep them minimal. What is it? Is it 2%? Is it 3%? But I don't see the word cut because the debate here is that everything has been submitted at such a higher level. So I just hope you take that into consideration when you start hearing the word cut, 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 not a cut. We're just asking to minimize. I think there should be some reasonable conservativeness in minimizing the increase. And I hope you take that thought home with you tonight. Thank you.
Good evening again. Marty Cameron, 469 Ocean Road. I don't know if this is the third cycle or the fourth or what it is. Actually, when you sit back and you listen to all the comments from the beginning to the end, you try to find something common. And I picked up a theme that I see running through the conversations and the comments here tonight. And it's us against them. And it's not on just one level. It's like seniors against the 35-year, 40-year-olds, and so forth. The seniors are saying, I can't cut it anymore. My income is fixed. When they raise, I get a 3 or 4% raise on the Social Security. Bump. The next day, HUD says, oh, we'll take that for Medicare Part B. Every nickel is gone. So they find things difficult. With everything going up, of course, the cost of energy and fuel and so forth is astronomical. And that applies to everybody, young or old, whether you're 18 or 89. However, the theme is, it seems that, okay, you've done your thing, you're 80 years old or whatever, and it's time you sell the house, get out of it, and move someplace where you can live. And let a couple of young people move in that can, they both work, and they can pay the bills. So, in other words, the theme is, you can't cut it, bug out. I don't know if you came to that conclusion through some of the comments, but that's what I gathered. And some of it comes from, like, I can understand where they're coming from, the parents here that have 2, 3, 4 children in school. I can understand everybody wants their children to get a good education. And that's the teacher, the student, and the parents are all involved. However, they expect a lot out of that teacher. And I believe for the most part, probably 90%, 95% of the teachers are fine. They do a heck of a job. They do more than what they're asked for, and so forth. I understand that. In some places, and not just teachers, I'm talking about everybody, firemen or whatever you want, in any kind of job, like at the shipyard or what, there's a certain amount of, say, dead wood that's just hanging in there, and that's that. But that's in any place. But the parents want, they demand all of this for their kids because they want to see them grow up. They need to have an education to get the find of jobs. So I can understand from their viewpoint what they're trying to get across, but at the same time, it comes across as, if you can't pay for that, then leave town. So this is the theme, that the thread that I see going through. I don't like that thread. I don't know what you people think about it, but that's what I see happening here tonight. Thank you.
Then again, there aren't that many people left. But we're in our third and final reading, and I'm sorry, please come on up. I apologize.
My name is Faith Croto. I live at 143 Holly Lane, and I have 3 children in the Portsmouth School. I can honestly say I have never attended one of these, but the school budget is the price that we're going to pay here, and I felt it was important to come out tonight. The reason I don't usually attend is I work at night. And I'm just discouraged. I'm really dumbfounded tonight. It's like the elderly against, he's right, the 35 and 40-year-olds. And I'm just discouraged on how they I mean, obviously we have to come to some agreement here. And I just don't, I don't see how they cannot think education is important. That's our future. Our kids are our future. And I feel that there's other ways we could cut the money. And I don't think education is one of them. Thank you.
Okay, seeing nobody else for this third and final reading, we will close it. And thank everybody for coming this evening, especially those that stuck around for a couple hours. And just so you know, a couple housekeeping sort of things. We're going to have a work session on June 13th. That's a week from Monday?
Yesterday.
Yesterday. That will not have public interaction, but certainly it'll be televised and it'll be held here, and you certainly can come and observe. And I believe we are scheduled to have a vote on a final budget that'll be a part of our next regular council meeting, which is June 19th. That at least is what it's scheduled for right now. So June 13, June 19 are sort of the next two dates to keep in mind, and we very much appreciate you coming out again tonight. Thank you. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Passes 8-0. Thanks again.